Welcome everyone to this webinar hosted by Toradex with the title, Build Your Own Embedded Carrier Board Easily. This is part one of a two-part series. In this session, we will be focusing on the system design and schematic capturing. In the upcoming second part, we'll cover the PCB design, we'll talk about PCB stackup, signal return path, and high-speed layout. My name is Peter Lische. I'm a senior hardware development engineer at Toradex. I'm working for Toradex for more than 12 years. So if you have used a Toradex computer module in the past, the chances are actually pretty high that I was involved in the hardware development of this product. Before we dive into the webinar, let me cover a few organizational points. Please use the chat window of the webinar tool if you have any technical issues and wish to let us know. At the end, we will also have an interactive question and answer session. You can type your question in the chat window at any time, and I will be picking them up at the end. The webinar itself will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing. What is on today's agenda? So I will start with a brief introduction of Toradex, so especially for the ones who don't know Toradex that well. Then I will try to convince you why you should use a computer module in your next design. I'm going to show you how to select the right computer module from Toradex, because we have different families, different modules. We'll then talk about system design, and we will have a live demonstration of our pinout designer. We'll then talk about the reference designs, where you can get them, how to use them. I will then show you how I do component evaluations. And at the end, we'll talk about schematic reviews, how we handle that in Toradex. And as mentioned before, at the end, we will have a question and answer session together. With that, let's get started. So who is Toradex? What are we doing? So Toradex is focusing on making embedded computing easy to use so that you can use simple technology, you can access the latest technology for your product development. We are doing this by providing a highly reliable ARM system or module, and we include software and support with it. We are steering to offer the lowest cost of ownership to you. That means we are not focusing on having the lowest cost of the module itself. We are considering the whole development effort, the time to market it takes for you, and the long-term maintenance. So at the end, you are going to have the lowest cost of ownership. We are proud of being able to have industry-leading support with our modules. That includes a very active community and a developer page with more than 800 articles, which are updated daily. As you can see on this map, Toradex is all over the world. We have 8 different offices, which have local support and warehouses. The headquarters is in Lucerne in Switzerland. That's also where I'm coming from. You probably have already noticed my Swiss accent. What are the typical applications our customers are using our products? So a lot of our customers are using it in industrial automation. They also use it for healthcare and laboratory equipment. They do measurement and test tools. We have customers using it in transportation. This includes also, for example, special vehicles like harvesting machines. We have customer using it in smart city solutions. That includes also building automation. We have customer doing retail and ticketing system with our modules. Typical projects are between a few hundred to a few 10,000 products per year that our customers are using. This is quite a sweet spot for using a computer module. So we at Toradex, we are focusing on the computer on module, the COM, at the SOM, system on modules. So we have three different families. We have the Apalis, the Colibri, and the Verdin family. Within the family, they are pin compatible, so that you can even swap them. Beside the modules, we also have off-the-shelf carrier boards, or we have a huge partner network, which also they also support, some of them supporting off-the-shelf carrier boards, or can help you with developing a carrier board. But of course, we are here today on this webinar in order to learn how you can do your own carrier board. As I said before, we are bundling our modules with software support. So we have our own Linux PSP that we support. Then we have Windows C on selected modules. We also provide free RTOS, Android, and a few time we have our Torizon platform. So let me show you what Torizon is before we actually go to the real hardware stuff. So Torizon is supposed to be an easy-to-use industrial Linux software platform. The idea behind this is that we get fast time-to-market, ready-to-use Linux distribution. It's completely open source, so there is no lock-in. You can change it according to your needs. It provides simple updates with over-the-air update capabilities. That includes systems that you can even have that your power is dropping off at the worst possible moment and the system still does not break. Torizon also offers security. That means on one side, frequent software updates and the access to the security features of the system on modules. It also provides a real-time option and it's based on the Yocto project. So it's using Docker for running containers on the platform. We have Visual Studio integration and Codesys. So why should you actually use a computer module instead of just designing in your own system on module, your own processor down? So in the last couple of years, system on modules got more and more complex. We have now SoCs which have more than 1,500 balls. Some of them are having more than 15 different voltage rails, which some of them you need to provide up to 15 amps to them. Beside that, you have really high speed RAM design. So we run up to 3.2 gigahertz RAMs right now. So that makes the whole thing really complex. So by using a module, you can get faster to the market and lower your risk. And of course, we are bundling everything with software, because if you use just an SoC from an SoC vendor, you're probably only getting a basic PSP with it. But we are offering way more. So Toradex actually has many more software engineers working on the PSP and Torizon than we actually have hardware engineers. When you have an SoC which has a lot of pins and high speed, you probably need a really high layer count PCB. You very likely need a special via technology, double stacked vias, buried vias, all these kind of stuff which make PCB quite expensive. And PCBs are paid per square meter, which means if you're able to use a small computer module which reduce the size of this expensive PCB, you can then just make your carrier board easily with a 4, 6, maybe 8 layer board, which is way cheaper. And don't forget the supply chain. So by not needing to procure RAM, flash, all this kind of stuff, you can offload your supply chain. And since our modules are pin compatible, they have even an upgrade path for different type of processors. So when you start the design, the first thing you have to do is you have to select actually the family you want to design your board to. As I mentioned before, We have the Colibri, the Apalis, and the Verdin family. They are pin compatible in the main features within the family. So what I'm trying to do now is explain you what are the differences between these families, for which ones you should select which computer family. Let me start with the Colibri family. So the Colibri basically founded the success of Toradex. We came out with the first Colibri module more than 15 years ago. It was Colibri PXA270. Back then, the PXA270 processor was still called an Intel processor, which then was later sold to Marvell, this business. We then later adopted other Marvell processors, also have NVIDIA processors and a bunch of NXP SoCs on our module. The Colibri itself is based on a 200-pin SODIMM connector, which you probably know from laptop RAM. The Colibri is focusing on low-speed interfaces such as UART, I2C, SPI, PWM, parallel bus, SD card, GPIOs, USB, fast Ethernet, so 100 megabit Ethernet, parallel LCD interface, resistive touch, or analog audio. I mean, when the first Colibri PXA270 came out, it did not even have a high-speed USB 2.0. It only had fast and low-speed USB. Nowadays, all Colibris have USB 2.0 high-speed. So Colibri is really focusing on the lower end of the interfaces, but it has a variety of different SoCs available. Don't be afraid of using a Colibri module today because of its age. I mean, we just are currently launching the Colibri IMX 8X in the Colibri family. This module will be at least available until 2030. And the past has actually shown that it's very likely that it's even going to be beyond that. About 7 years ago, we introduced the Apalis family. So we saw a need that more and more people are needing higher speed interfaces, which we were not able to bring out with the Colibri family. So these kind of interfaces are PCI Express, HDMI, MIPI CSI camera, MIPI DSI display, gigabit Ethernet, etc. The Apalis is based on the MXM3 connector. The MXM3 connector is used also for gaming laptops, for the graphic cards. It has a higher pin count and the module is slightly bigger than the Colibri. Another thing that we have seen is that more and more SoCs are going into the higher performance side. So they provide way more computing power, but that also means they need more power to do that. And of course, they bring more power dissipation. So they need to be, you need to be able to dissipate more power on these. The original Colibri was not designed really to add a heatsink on it. So it's possible to glue on a simple heat spreader or a heatsink to it, but it was never really designed for it. So that's something we did on the Apalis. So here we have an easy solution to mount a heatsink if you need one in order to go with the higher end SoCs. This year at the Embedded World in Nuremberg, we have introduced the Verdin family. Verdin is basically combining the advantages of the Colibri module with the Apalis module. So it has about the same size as a Colibri, even slightly smaller. It uses the SODIMM DDR4 pin, and it adds additional high-speed interfaces like PCI Express, like HDMI, like a DSI display, like CSI camera, like gigabit Ethernet. Then there is one thing we also did with the Verdin. So instead of just using 3.3 volt as an input voltage for the module, we widened it up. So the Verdin can run from 3.13 volt, 5 volt to 5.5 volt. This makes it really convenient to use the Verdin module on a single cell lithium battery system. So it's very easy to do a battery management system in which you can run the module directly from the lithium battery voltage. But the module can, of course, also run from 3.3 volt or 5 volt, which makes it also really convenient for USB applications. We did also another thing on the Verdin. We lowered the I/O voltage from 3.3 volt to 1.8 volt. It has a huge advantage because when you run a system from lithium battery, you don't need to buck boost it, because 3.3 volt, you need to buck boost on a battery system. And the other thing is, of course, you consume less power on 1.8 volt, and it is future-proof, because we see more and more SoCs that are coming out which don't support any more 3.3 volt higher voltages. So it's the future. So even though Verdin is focusing on the low power side, so it's mainly focusing on less than 5 watts, we also include on the Verdin an option to have easy to mount cooling solution. If you want to know more about the Verdin family, my colleague Simon Horvath did a whole webinar only talking about the Verdin. So I highly recommend you to check out the recording of that webinar. So after you have selected the family, you have to select which module or which modules you want to use with your carrier board. I mean, I remember you that you can use actually multiple modules in the same family since they are pin compatible. So ideally, you know what interfaces you need. And ideally, you know how much performance you need for your application. I mean, one way to find out how much performance you're going to need is using one of our off-the-shelf carrier boards over development boards and try it out directly on the module and check it. Maybe you even need special features, like maybe you need some real-time M4 cores, or you need 3D graphics, or you need artificial intelligence acceleration. If you do that, it would already narrow down the selection of the modules. On our website, we have a product selector, which allows you to compare different modules and see what kind of features they have. So I highly recommend you to check out there first. On our developer center, we have additional information to the modules. So also I recommend you to go there. And of course, I highly recommend you to talk to our local Toradex support team, our FAEs, which can help you to figure out which module would fit best on your design. And there is something that you can do with the Toradex Pinout Designer. So you can actually use it also to compare modules. So that's what we are going to do now. So I want to show you how to use the Toradex Pinout Designer. But before we actually go into do that, I want to give you some extra theory what pin multiplexing means on a module. So here on the right side here, we have a block diagram of a module. So you see the module contains an SoC, system on chip, and it has some connectors here which go to the carrier board, and it has maybe some extra peripherals on it. The SoC itself has internal interfaces. So these interfaces, some of them are maybe even having multiple instances like this I2C here. Then these kind of signals are going to this multiplexer. So many of these pins of the SoC, they have a multiplexer at the output. This multiplexer allows you to select between different internal signals. So that makes it already quite complex because, of course, you cannot use one internal interface signal on multiple SoC pins because that could make your system unstable. And then, of course, you cannot use multiple internal interface signals on the same SoC pins. So you have to make sure that you configure this in the way that you can use all your required functions. But to make it even more complex, some of the SoC pins can be connected together to one single module pin in order to give you more options, more features on a pin. Or it can be the other way around, that one SoC pin is connected to multiple connector pins in order to provide better compatibility with multiple ports. So all these, you need to make sure that you configure it correctly. But we have our Pinout Designer tool, which guides you with this. Currently, we have two different versions of this tool. We have the offline version, which runs only on the Windows. We have that since about 5 years. We are going to use it afterwards, and I'm going to show you how to use it. We are currently also working on a browser-based version of the Pinout Designer. So it will be able to run it on the Linux and any other operating system directly in the browser. The browser system also provides an API so that software can grab information from it. It is possible to import and export between these two versions. So with that, let's try to figure out how to use it. So I'm going to try to demonstrate here the tool. So first of all, what you want to do is you want to go to developer.toradex.com. So here under carrier board design, you will find all the information, including the Pinout Designer tool. So here you will be able to download the tool and to have some overview of the features. So I've already downloaded it and started it. First thing you have to do with the Pinout Designer tool, you have to select which family you want to design your carrier board with. The same thing that we have started with our webinar. So I'm going to select here the Colibri. And then I need to select which module I want to design it for. So I'm going to select here the IMX7 as an example. It has now loaded a lot of different interfaces here on this tree. So there are different types of interfaces for us. So we have the interfaces we try to keep compatible between the different modules. We call these interfaces standard interfaces. Additionally to them, we have additional interfaces and interface pins on the modules, which are not always compatible between the module, and they also sometimes are not fully supported by the software, so you have to check whether the software actually supports them. We called them possible interfaces in this tool. So the first thing, I highly recommend you to go into View, Function, and select Show Standard Only. This limits your list to the standard interfaces only, though that you mainly only use the standard functions, which are fully supported. So, for example, our design, let's say we want to have some UARTs. I can click on it. It automatically enabled all three available UARTs. Two of them are having handshake, hardware handshake, while one is only having RX and TX. Maybe you want to have some USB, some resistive touch. Maybe you want to have some SPI, some SD card, PWM. You want to maybe have an LCD display. You want to maybe have some I2C. You want to maybe have an Ethernet on it, and maybe you want to have a camera with it. Now we got red. So there is something wrong with our configuration. The problem is, and we see that on the right side here on the list, that the PWM pins here got red. They are in conflict with the camera pins. So if I scroll up here, I can see that pin 67 and 59 are used for the camera and the PWM. So we cannot do that at the same time. So what we're going to do here for now, we're just going to disable these two PWMs in order to resolve it. So let's say I want to have more than just these three UARTs on my design. I need more UARTs, let's say. For that, we need to go back and enable the possible pins as well, because we have only three standard UART pins. With that, we can see now that our module has actually up to 7 UARTs to be used. So let's say we are going to use a fourth one and the fifth one. Again, you're getting in trouble. Something is red. So let's see what we can do here. So I'm opening up, by opening up the pin here, or the interface here, I see the interface is actually available on three different pins, on pin 27, 31, and 86. And we also see here that we get different colors. So red means that is currently in a conflict with another pin. Yellow means that this pin is going to be in conflict if I'm going to select it. So it gives me kind of a warning that I shouldn't select it, because otherwise I'm still having a conflict. And white means that everything would be okay to use it. So by using the white one, we can resolve our issue. So let's go ahead and maybe want to have also can. So we are going to enable can. And again, we are having an issue. So let's try to resolve them as well. We have learn, just use the white ones. And we are okay. So you actually can resolve here, check whether whether it's possible to use all these interfaces at the same time, whether you can resolve the multiplexing. So what do we have here in this table here? What can we see in this table? So on the first column here, we see the Toradex names. So that's how we name the signals ourselves. In the second column, we see the pin numbers. These are the numbers that the pins have on the module connector. The third column here, we have already seen, this is for the conflict. So it shows us to which signal something is in conflict. And then on the last one here, we see how the SOC vendor is calling the interface pin. That can be quite different. I mean, when you look at here, this pin, for example, we call it LCD1, because there could be two LCD interfaces on some modules. Then we call it 18-bit, because there can be different color mapping on the LCD. And then green 0, while the SOC manufacturer just calls it data 6. Don't get confused with these namings. I mean, it can even be that when you look here, that we call something RX, while the SOC manufacturer calls it TX. The reason for that is that simply, in this case, NXP has decided to call RX and TX the other way around. So please use the Toradex names, so RX and TX, so they are looking from the module side. So RX actually receiving to the module and TX is sending out of the module. Also, don't get confused with the numbering here. So it can be that the numbers are completely different. So it's here 1, 2, 3, 5, 4. So the reason for that is that we use different orders sometimes in order to show compatibility or give you compatibility. Under view, you can go to module specific information and you can enable even more columns. So what we have now here. So you can have some extra nodes for each of these interface pins. You can have the alternate function. So that is basically showing you how the internal multiplexer is configured to which input itself. So this is an important information for configuring then the registers of the multiplexer. We also have the name of the SOC pin. This is an important information when you want to go into the data sheet or reference manual of the SOC itself. We can also have some extra nodes of SOC pins. So for example, here there is a node that this pin can only be used, or you have to be careful because there are two SOC pin connected to one module pin. The last column here, we see again the compatibility type. So either whether the pin is a standard function, which means fully supported, or it is a possible function. So possible again means that maybe there's not compatible between different modules, or the software is maybe not supported. So you have to check out whether our software does out of the box the support for these pins. For now, let me disable again all this additional information, because what we are going to do next is what I have teased already quite a while ago, that we are going to compare different modules. So by going in here, I can enable other modules to my list. For example, I can enable all of these modules, and I can immediately see what functions are available on which modules. So I can see here, for example, that the CAN interface I've selected is only available on the IMX7. I mean, that's kind of unfortunate, because I maybe want to do a design which is compatible with all these modules. So let's try whether we can make it better. So when you go into the CAN here, I can open it up, and you immediately see that we got new colors. So we still have yellow. Yellow means still that when you click on it, you will get a conflict. But we got now also gray. Gray means that this pin is not compatible with all the selected modules. So if I'm going to select a gray one, there will be no compatibility between all of them. But we also have a white one here. White means this pin is actually going to be compatible between all these different modules. So we will solve that issue. Let's see whether we can do the same on CAN 3. Unfortunately, there is no white one, but I know that if I'm selecting here 178, at least I get compatibility between the IMX 6, 6 ULL, and the IMX 7. So it gives me an overview to which modules it is compatible. I can also see down here that my UART 5 and my UART D and E, they are not compatible with the other modules. Maybe only RX and TX are compatible with the vibrate here. But again, it is not a standard function, so we only have three standard UARTs here. What else can you do? You can actually go here, you can save the configuration. You can load the configuration, of course, and you can export it to Excel, which means you can use it then for drawing your schematic or giving it to your software team in order to set up everything according to your configuration. I want to give you now a sneak preview to our online version. So the pinout.horizon.io, it's already available. So this is the complete online version. So I'm going to load it. Here, I'm going to use a template. So templates are basically just our carrier boards, the off-the-shelf carrier boards. So I'm going to load it. By the way, these templates you also have in the offline version. So they're just called the example configurations that are included in the package you can download. So it's now loading it. Should be ready soon. So the tool, the online version, looks very similar. So you have also these tables in which you can compare features here. You can immediately see that the camera, the parallel camera here, is missing on these two modules. And of course, you have the same drop down in which you can configure it. This is currently work in progress, so we are adding more and more features to it. With that, we are going back to our presentation, and I'm coming to my first poll. So I would like to know from you guys out there whether you have already used the Pinout Designer before. So please select whether you have used it already for multiplexing a module, or whether you have used it for comparing different modules, or that you're planning actually to use it in the future, or that you don't see much value in this program. Okay, I'm letting the poll running for a few more seconds. Okay, let's close it and share the results. Okay, very interesting. So most of you haven't used it, but they're going to plan to use it. I hope it was due to my presentation would make me feel really happy. Thank you very much for participating this poll. So as you have now completed the system design, you have selected which pins you want to use on your module, you want to start with schematics. The first thing I really highly recommend you is to go and read our carrier board design guides. So for each of our module families, we have a carrier board design guide available. In this guide, we have additional information to each of the interfaces. There is information how you should power the module. There is a lot of things written down to consider when you design your carrier board. Of course, for each module, there is also a datasheet available. So please also read that one, because sometimes there is some restriction on certain interfaces or certain speciality on certain modules. So please be aware of it. And then, of course, I highly recommend you to use our community platform under toradex.com/community. You will find a lot of questions already there. Or if you want to raise your own questions, please do that there. If you don't want to do that publicly, you can do that privately, which means then it's only visible to our engineers, which then get in contact with you and try to answer you the questions. And of course, we have reference design schematics. So I'm going to show you where to find it and how you can use them. So when we go back to our developer.toradex.com website, again, under carrier board design. First of all, you will find there the carrier board design guides, all in here, and you find the reference designs. So for all of our carrier boards, off-the-shelf carrier boards, we provide PDF schematics, assembly drawings, bill of materials, and the complete Altium Designer files. So you can download it, no registration needed for it. And we have something else. It's a little bit hidden. When you click on these images here, it opens up a web viewer of the Altium Designer. Especially if you don't have Altium Designer in your company, it's an easy way to explore our schematic. So with that, you can actually go into and dive into the schematics. You can even see the PCB with it. So it's currently downloading it. So we can go in, disable layers here. For example, if you zoom in, you even see the names of the signals here. You can even see the PCB in 3D here, or you can check out the BOM. But you can even do more. So for example, when you go in here, click on the component, and then go back to the PCB, it highlights it directly, even does it under 3D. So you can see directly where this component is located. And the cool thing is you can even do that with net here. If I select the net, then I can go into the PCB. It highlights me where this net is, and it even does it in 3D. So you can actually see in 3D how we have routed this this I2C here on this carrier board. So it's a really easy way to explore our reference designs, especially if you don't use Altium Designer in your company. But of course, if you're using Altium Designer, it's probably way easier directly to download the design files and use your own tool. Okay. With that, we are ready for my second poll. So I would like to know from you, what would be for you the preferred way to get reference schematic? Is it just PDF files or are using Altium project files, or maybe you're using Mentor Graphics, Expedition, or PADS. Maybe you're using KiCad, or maybe you're using Eagle in your company. Okay, I'm going to run the poll for a few more seconds. Okay, thank you very much for participating. I'm going to close it and share it with you. Okay, that's very interesting. So about half of the people are actually just using PDF files. Of course, that's the easiest way to use them. But then also a lot of you are using Altium. And I'm surprised how many they're actually using KiCad. Okay, thank you very much. So our reference design contains carefully selected components. I mean, selecting a component for an embedded design is a really crucial thing because, I mean, we are tending to use to design for longevity, so we need to have something that is available for a long time. So I'm going to show you how I'm normally doing component selection, how I'm doing it. So as an example here, I was selecting an LDO for a 1.2 volt, which I needed on one of my boards. So what I'm normally doing, I'm doing a table in which I'm trying to compare all the different features of the components I found. Of course, this table is normally way longer and has more different key features that I'm covering. So what I'm doing is I'm going to the different manufacturers I know that I maybe could deliver such an IC, then I search for it, I read data sheets, and I collect all these data. But of course, that list is going to be long, and I would like to know already, are the components in this list, are they easy to get purchased? Are there easy available? Are they tending to already go not recommended anymore for new designs, or are they going to be discontinued? And I would already have kind of an indication what could be a price range for it. What I'm using for that is I'm using two websites. I'm using Octopart and I'm using Siva for it. Both of them are giving you a really simple way to get information whether a certain component is available on online distributor, what is the current stock level, and what are prices of it, and let you compare it. Siva even allows you to see historical stock levels and historical prices. So if I see, for example, here a component which had quite some up and downs in the stock level, that gives me an indication that this component is probably a high runner. So I can probably use it with some confidence that it's not going to be discontinued soon because nobody is using it. So it just gives me additional information, which I then put into my list as a kind of a price indication here. And I do kind of a, for me, an indication whether something is easy available or looks like almost no online distributor had it. But then of course, I'm selecting a couple of candidates, like here I've selected six of them, which I put into the next round. With these ones, I'm going to my procurement team and ask them for getting real quotes and getting in contact with the distributors and the manufacturer to know more about these devices. Are they really good? What is the availability? What is there any longevity of these ones? So really, by narrowing it down by these websites, I'm able to make sure that I'm not overwhelming my procurement team with asking for 30, 40 different devices, the prices and availability. So after we have finished the schematic, there is one thing which for me personally is really important. It is the schematic review, because my goal is to have things first time right. So when you buy a Toradex product, which comes with version 1.0, that means you actually get really the first PCB version that was ever produced in this product. So we start our PCB numbering with 1.0. We're not starting them with 0.9. I'm proud to say that in the last couple of years, even complex modules, they were all booting with PCB version 1.0. How do we achieve that? Well, we do that with the boring netlist review. So what we do is we really do reviews on a netlist level, because the netlist forces us to look at the design from a different perspective. It really allows us to check each and every single connection on the board. Because how often did you forget to connect the pin? Maybe it's just because the tool was slightly misaligned and you think that graphically it is connected, but it isn't. Or have you ever mixed up RX and TX on a bus with a netlist? These kind of things are normally popping up quite easily. What we also do is, especially for bigger designs, we check netlists in two people. That means there is the guy who designs the schematics sitting together with a colleague and they discuss it. So one guy is reading down the netlist, the other one is comparing it to a reference design, to a known design. They mark down everything they have checked in order to check whether they forgot anything. It's really important that these two guys get in a dialogue. So especially if there are new circuits on it, the colleague, the designer needs to defend his design. And the other one needs really to ask the nasty questions. So please explain me, how did you do it? Why did you do it this way? Why didn't you do it another way around? Please explain me that circuit. So it's really important that these two guys get in a dialogue, because during this dialogue, you find out so many errors that are in the schematics. So sometimes these reviews take us multiple days in two people. So this is quite expensive, but it was always worth the time, because almost every time you find something that would have made the board not booting, and at the end you would have hunted down this error for hours or even days, and then probably needed a respin of the whole board to make it running. So for us, netlist review is really the key for making the first thing right. So that brings me to my last poll, because I'm really curious to hear from you how you're handling reviews. Are you not doing reviews at all? Or are you just sending the schematics to a colleague for review? Or are you sitting down with a colleague and discuss the schematics? Or are you doing netlist reviews in a similar way we are doing it at Toradex? Or maybe you use some other sources like the SOM provider, which helps you with that review. Okay, I'm going to keep the poll open for a few more seconds, so please vote. Okay, I'm going to close it and reveal the results. Okay, it's very interesting. So only 16% of you do a netlist view. Okay, so most of you just do it on a schematic level. Okay, very interesting. Thank you very much for participating here. So with that, we are actually at the end of the webinar, of the first part of it. In the second part, I will then going to talk about layout, how we do layout, how you do PCB stack up, how important that is for resolving EMC issues. I will then also highlight the signal return path for high-speed layout design. So in general, I will talk about how to handle the challenges of routing high-speed signals on a carrier board with the help of Altium Designer. So we have time now to answer some of your questions. So if you still have some questions, please feel free to put them into the box, and I'll try to answer it. So I'm going now through the questions. So let's see. Okay. The first question I got was, do you have any plans for Apalis or Verdin NVIDIA SOM update with something more up to date than Tegra K1? That's a very interesting and very good question. Actually, we are really would love to do an updated NVIDIA module. We are really in talk with NVIDIA. The problem right now is that NVIDIA is promoting their own modules. So we are really in contact with them and trying to get hands on later products. But currently, yeah, unfortunately, we cannot do it. Is there any fee to pay using your reference design? If yes, is it for volume, single, free, etc.? Very good question as well. No, there is no fee at all. So everything you can download directly from our website, please use it. I mean, theoretically, you can even produce our off-the-shelf boards on your own, because our goal is not making money out of the carrier boards. Our goal is selling you the modules. So you're free to use it. You can even directly use it, do a few changes on the design. You can even download the Gerber files if you want, no problems. Is there a free viewer available for Altium Designer? That's a good question. So there used to be a free Altium viewer available from Altium. Unfortunately, it's not anymore available. So you still can get a viewer, and you can apply for a limited viewer license, but unfortunately it's not unlimited. So we would have to pay for unlimited time. But there are two ways to work around it. So the first one I want to show you on the website. So if you go to Altium web viewer, I think it's called Altium/viewer. Yes, Altium.com viewer. So basically what you can do, you can upload an Altium file there, project file, and then you have exactly the same experience as I've shown you here. So basically this one is an embedded Altium viewer on our website. So you can do that even with other designs, you can upload it here. So that's one version, one way to do it. Another way is if you have in your company already, if you're using already Altium in your company, but you don't have enough licenses, because very often some people just need to view a project, they don't work on it, don't need to work on it. So what you can do is with the latest Altium version, you can directly in the license manager, you can click on it and say you want to apply for a viewer license, which means then you can use that license for viewing design. So you shortly have to grab the regular license, create the viewer license, and then you can relieve the regular license and give it to the guys in your company which are working on the design if you're just using the viewer. Okay, then another question. What is the difference between standard and possible function? Yes. So I'm going again in here and show you here the compatibility type in which we can see standard and possible. So standard means for us, these are functions we try to keep compatible within the family. So these are our standard functions. We also support, we have fully software support for the standard interfaces. So these are the ones you should mainly use. But then of course, when you need, for example, here, we had the need for an extra UART. So you can use then the possible. Possible means it is possible to use them. They are maybe not compatible with other modules, as you can see here. So there's only limited compatibility here, for example, with the VF61. And maybe there is some restriction in the software. Of course, here for the UART, there's not going to be any restriction in software because it's using the same driver as for the standard UART. So it's just more when you have an exotic interface, you should first check whether there is driver support available for it. Next one, can we create a carrier board with GPIOs for which their functions can be programmed as I2C, SPI0, etc.? That's it. Want to reuse the same pins for the carrier board with different functionality based on different circumstances? Well, this is actually possible to do, yes. Even though it is most of the time not intended by the SoC manufacturer that you do that, that you do change the function on the runtime. But it is actually possible. When you use our standard Linux BSP, you will find a tool that is called, a GPIO tool is called. And on this one, you can actually on the fly change the function of a pin. But be aware that maybe there are some things with loading drivers, etc. Maybe you also have to check out with our software team on this one, because I'm really purely a hardware guy. So from the hardware side, it is possible to do it, but you have to check with the software guys. But at least I know that you can go from GPIOs to a function that is possible with that tool. Next one I got. Once you have the hardware and you put or remove components, how do you let know to Torizon the hardware? Is there a tool to quickly map hardware to device tree in Torizon? That's a really good question. We are actually currently working on that. So as I already mentioned, the online version of the Pinout Designer is coming with an API, and we want to make use of this in the future. It's currently not here, so currently it is not possible directly import it and to create device tree, but it's one of our goals because we see a lot of demand for that, that you have an easy way from the Pinout Designer tool into your device tree itself. How do you do netlist reviews for redesigned products? So if we do a redesign and we just change a few things, I normally do just a delta review, which means I only check the differences. I made a small script which allows me just to compare two netlists and highlight only the differences between the two netlists. With that, I make sure that if I redesign a board, that I didn't screw up something, so I didn't break something that was running before, so I can check only the differences. So that's what how I'm doing or redoing it if we just do a redesign. So then we have the question, cadence file format would be great for reference design. I really agree on that. I don't know whether it's so easy. It's easy to do because the thing is we are actually working with the Altium Designer for our carrier boards. So we can convert it, but conversion normally can cause us some problems. So we have to check that. The thing is I actually are having very often the same kind of situation on my own. A lot of our reference designs from the some manufacturers are coming in cadence format, and we are using internally Mentor Graphics and Altium Designer. So we also have very often the problem that we cannot really import it. So I find it normally easier to actually redo the whole thing than doing an import, which then causes problems. Does Toradex support layout review? Yes, we do, but please keep in mind we have limited resources, so please talk to your local FAE and check whether there is what are the opportunities, whether we have a time slot for doing it, and also to talk about business opportunities. Is the netlist review service free? So the thing is, it goes into the same direction as the other one, whether we do a layout review. So yes, I don't know, the free is, it we cannot offer really it for free. I mean, it depends on the business perspective. But yeah, from time to time, we actually do also netlist reviews. So I even did from time to time some review of customer boards. And when I'm doing a review of a customer board, I always ask also for the netlist, because even a customer board, I try to do on a netlist level if I do a customer board review. Which CIE tool is Toradex using for designing carrier boards and modules? I partially already covered that question. So for the carrier boards, we have been always using Altium Designer, because it is the tool that most of our customers are using. So it's the easiest path then to provide to customer reference designs directly. On the module itself, we have been using for a very long time Mentor Graphics Expedition, because we have HDI technology on it with sometimes double stacked vias, we have buried vias and all these kind of technologies. And in the past, it was not really possible to do that with Altium Designer, so we needed a better tool for that. But it's going to change now, because Altium has improved their tool really a lot in the few last years. So the Verdin module was actually the very first one with it, even the module in Altium Designer. So nowadays it is actually possible to do a complex design in Altium Designer, because it makes us for us easier to use only one tool. Are you planning to release a KitKat reference design schematic? It goes into the same direction as the question before with the Kaizens file. We are internally not using KitKat or Cadence, so we maybe can do some conversions, but we need to check whether how good that turns out. But of course, it would be quite beneficial for you to have it in that format. Which board can be used for high-speed video streaming? Which uses gigabit Ethernet? It's a good question. Probably you want to go towards the Apalis side. So in Apalis, we have gigabit Ethernet and we have the higher performance. So it could be, for example, an IMX 8 Quad Max. It may be depending on what you actually want to do. It maybe can even be an IMX 8X on that one, or maybe also a TK1. So please talk to your local FIE to get more information, or to get help with doing it. Do you have a minimalistic Verdin mini carrier board to start with? We are currently working on such a board, yes, but it's still, I don't know what the plans are, to release it. How would you differentiate between general purpose 32-bit MCU board and Toradex? So an MCU board, I mean, it comes first of all to the performance, of course, because our SoCs are tending more to the higher end. So higher end means multiple processors in it, graphic support on it. For example, we have a lot of modules with 3D graphic support, in which you can also have encoding, decoding of video, all this kind of stuff. So it's more towards the higher end than a regular MCU. Are there any special recommendations for differential pair lanes on the carrier board? Yes, there are. Well, I'm going to do a whole separate webinar just on layout, so it will be covered in there. But I can already tell you that you can go to our website here on the carrier board design, and then design guides. We have the carrier board layout design guide. So here you'll find a lot of information how you should do high-speed layouts. And then I have another one. So can you export pinout designer configuration to setting up device tree? Not right now, as I told already, but we are working on it. And then I think this is the last one we are doing for today. For digital image processing, which Toradex board would you advise? Digital image processing, probably I would go towards, depending on what are your needs, how much performance you need, you probably want to go towards the IMX 8 Quad Max, maybe even TK1, or if it is rather lower end, maybe an IMX 8X or M, the Verdin IMX 8M Mini. But again, please talk to your local FAE team that can help you with selecting the correct module. So with that, I think we can conclude. Thank you very much for attending. I hope you were able to get some insight how we work, how we do designs. Maybe you were able to get something out of it, how the pinout designer works. So yeah, if you have any further questions, please reach us out over the community website. My colleagues and I will be happy to answer them. I hope to see you again, hopefully in the second part of this webinar. Thank you very much.